Good evening, friends. At the onset, may I extend my heartiest congratulations to LG MEP for touching this milestone achievement of 25th talk during the lockdown period within 4 months record time. Socially distanced, were we? Not at all. Only physically, we were distant, socially integrated, connected, motivated, vibrant for a noble cause. A visionary foresight of 12 disciples of founder IFSA members in 1972-73 who came together with a strong belief of taking science to society using science and technology. How strong and powerful their vision may have been, for look at how it has sustained, how IFSA has sustained over almost the fifth decade. Today's program is yet another witness to their dream. IFSA is an All India social welfare voluntary non-profit secular non-political charitable organization with 11 branches. The objectives are fivefold: to take science to masses, to develop scientific temperance society, to promote scientific accomplishments among women scientists, to understand the problems of women in science and provide solutions for women empowerment, and be a representative body of women in science and technology. The activities are conducted under two wings of science programs and community programs. A lot of these are all there on our net, IFSA.net, every talk at the onset, there have been the managing trustees, the officiating heads who have been giving detailed presentations about IFSA. So it is, you know, we continue to do this. And we have the friends of IFSA, who are the several eminent male scientists and technologists giving us support to our cause and our objectives. And last yet not the least, I would also like to bring to your kind attention that since IFSA is a trust, and you know, it accepts donations for all its activities and infrastructure development and maintenance, and these donations are exempted under ATG under Section 12A of the Income Tax 1961. Donations can be made in cash, check, or bank transfer. For the bank, for more details, you can inquire and look at our website and mail us at ifsaheadquarters@gmail.com. Donations are also accepted from abroad in foreign currency. So we are here conducting all the activities, but we do need support in different ways, not only in finance, volunteering support, the integral support of all the expertise, the experiences. There are dedicated members. The visionaries started the things, and it has been like a relay and a legacy going on. And, you know, we have young, motivated, vibrant members too. And, you know, so at the onset, we invoke the blessings of all those who have started this and the goodwill and support of each and everyone joining in the objectives towards working for IFSA. And now it's indeed a privilege on behalf of the organizing committee of today's program to introduce our accomplished speaker, Shobha Ramanna Akkala, an educationist who has taught English and history to high school and junior college students at Father Agnel Institutes of Learning for almost 25 years before her superannuation in 2014. With her inherent flair for writing, she was also in charge of the school magazine. She has been a moderator in history for the SSC Board of Secondary and Higher Secondary Education for several years. Coming to her educational profile, besides a degree in psychology and a degree in education, she has also completed the Advanced Personality Development course from Nrityanjali, an institute for performing arts and personality development. She has been a life skills coach for different ICSE, SSE and CBSE schools in Mumbai. Besides, she has also conducted classes in basic gardening and dish gardens, etc. in Mumbai and Navi Mumbai. Her articles on education and gardening have been published in newspapers and magazines. And I'm sure with her writing flair, they have all had a great impact too. She is widely traveled and has a passion for reading. Environmental protection and quality education are subjects close to her heart. Shobha's contributions to IBSA are no less, exemplified by the earlier workshops she has conducted with impacted outcomes on all age groups. Here, including a workshop for house learners enrolled for our early learning childhood education on teacher empowerment course, and workshops for in-housers and outsiders on fairy garden for daycare children and on terrace gardening for all the interested learners. Certainly, all logged in audience are eagerly awaiting to listen to you today as you take us on a virtual journey to Buchat Gardens. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Param, for the wonderful introduction. You really made my day. Good afternoon to one and all present here. I'm really thankful to the Indian Women Scientists Association for providing me with this platform so that I can share something which really moved my heart. I would like to also thank all the members of IBSA, family and friends who are present here today. I know that I'm in the august company of eminent scientists, professors, teachers, ecologists, defense personnel, entrepreneurs. I sincerely hope that by the end of this session, you will be able to have a smile on your lips as you take in the kaleidoscopic artistry of the Buchat Gardens. The Buchat Gardens with exquisite blooms, stately trees, ornamental shrubs, pretty grasses, and a flamboyantly landscaped topography with its glorious fountains, amazing artifacts, bubbling brooks and flowing streams. It was last year, in July 2019, that I took the Alaskan cruise along with my son and his family. I had just retired from Agnes, finally retired the previous year, and I was really looking forward to this cruise on the luxurious liner called the Norwegian Joy. We visited many enchanting ports like Ketchikan, where we saw the tall totem poles. We went to Juneau, where we saw the humpback whales frolicking in the water. We went to icy Strait Point Hoona, which has the longest, largest zip line in the world. And our last port was Victoria, British Columbia in Canada. Victoria is named after the British Queen Victoria. As soon as we disembarked, I saw that the entire port was bustling with activity. There was bright sunshine, yet there was a nip in the air. There seemed to be flowers just about everywhere. You know, British Columbia, the district is nestled between the majestic Rocky Mountains on the east and the blue waters of the Pacific Ocean on the west. It is a district full of beaches, forests, and there's so much to do. You know, there are grasslands, you can go whale watching, you can go wildlife watching, you can take carriage tours, you can take a city tour, you know, you can go kayaking, you can go boating. There's so much to do. But we had decided that we would visit the Buchat Gardens. It was my daughter-in-law who had made this itinerary, and I'm really thankful to her that I got the opportunity to visit the Buchat Gardens. Victoria is a city with an old world charm. It was a British bastion. It was a colony of the Britishers. And that is why it has a lot of these heritage buildings. There are flowers, like I told you, just about everywhere. Every lamppost seemed to be straining under the weight of two enormous hanging baskets, full of flowers of all colors. You have fuchsias and begonias and lantanas and petunias, azaleas, you know, so many flowers. We passed by what is known as Chinatown. And in this Chinatown, there were many Japanese also living there. Like, we can't make out the difference. When you look at people, we say we don't know whether they're Chinese or Japanese. So at that time, there were a lot of Japanese living there during World War II. Very peaceful, law-abiding citizens minding their own business. But during the war, in the war, the Japan was on the other side of the war. It was opposing Canada, England, America, and the Allied countries. So all these Japanese, quite a few of them from Chinatown, were removed and put into camps. They had planted beautiful cherry trees near their homes. And when the war came to an end, they were told that they could go back home, but they had such sad memories of being, you know, just uprooted from their houses, and they didn't want to go back there. But the cherry trees that they planted there are testimony to the lives of the Japanese. If you look at the bottom on the left-hand side, you see the Parliament building. These are all heritage buildings, you know, with these domes, arches, colonnades, and columns. We passed by quite a few such buildings. And in the center, you can see a garden with a huge watering can. The driver of our shuttle, you know, we took a bus, which is a 40-minute drive from the port till Bouchard Gardens. So he kept on telling us what we were going to see. You know, he kept familiarizing us with the city. And I realized, you know, as we were moving, that the journey was going to be as good as the destination. We passed by apiaries, and they say that the honey that is available in British Columbia is of very high quality, probably because of the pretty flowers and the industrious bees. We also passed by sheep farms. We passed by, of course, the cherry trees, and we passed farms growing berries. All kinds of berries grow there. Raspberries, strawberries, loganberries, blackberries, blueberries. So it was such a beautiful journey, and we kept listening to what the driver was telling us. And finally, after 40 minutes, we reached our destination. When we reached the Bouchard Gardens, we came to what is known as the Water Wheel Square. If you can see in the top center, you can see the old water wheel that still exists in the Bouchard Gardens. And this Water Wheel Square has the coffee shop, the gift shop, and the visitor center. We all made our way to the visitor center to pick up brochures telling us, you know, what are the plants and trees available there. And we also got a map of the Bouchard Garden so that we could make our way easily. And of course, this huge signboard saying the Bouchard Gardens, over 100 years in bloom. It was such a beautiful place with all those flowers, the cannas, and the marigolds. And I just couldn't help sitting down and posing for a photograph. The Bouchard Gardens before and after. Robert Pym Bouchard, he was a cement manufacturer. And to manufacture cement, he required limestone. So they had this huge limestone quarry very close to their home. They settled down at Todd Inlet, and their home was called Benvenuto, which in Italian means welcome. All right. Now, Jenny Bouchard, she was not a gardener, but she was given a rose plant and some sweet peas, which she planted around her house way back in the year in 1904. That is such a long time ago. And that's how the garden started taking shape. Now, after some years, the entire limestone in the quarry got exhausted. And therefore, Mrs. Bouchard, when she looked, you know, Jenny Bouchard, when she looked at the quarry, she felt very sad. She said, oh God, it looks so ugly, so desolate. And we need to do something about it. I quote her words, she said, we created something ugly, and now we must create something beautiful. Now, Jenny Bouchard was a woman well ahead of her times. At a time when most of the upper class women, they only thought of marrying well, you know, rich guys and settling down. She was a trained chemist. She was very adventurous. You know, she had flown in hot air balloons. She had taken early flights when people were terrified of sitting in an aeroplane. And She had this artistic genius or brilliance because of which she was able to transform the, you know, the desolate quarry into what you see on the right. The, you can see the before and after pictures. Another thing I would like to point out is the two arbor vitae trees in the before picture. These are the huge, you know, tall evergreen tuja trees, which in Hindi we call them mor pankhi. Those trees are still surviving. And there's a lookout point to these sunken gardens. And I believe that these two trees, you know, which are on either side of the pathway to the sunken gardens, are the most photographed place, is the most photographed place in the Bouchard Gardens. And I'm very happy that I was able to take this iconic photograph. If you look at the Bouchard Gardens today, you will not be able to believe that it was a desolate, unused quarry. The Bouchards, they got, you know, horse loads of soil from the nearby farms. They did all this excavation work. They removed all the stones. They piled them up. And later on, those got converted into elevated beds. They filled the entire place with soil. And the, you know, the deepest part of the quarry was converted into a lake. And today, the sunken garden, which was the erstwhile quarry, is one of the most beautiful places in the entire gardens. This is another picture of the sunken garden. In tulip time, thousands of tulips are growing there. You can see the color combinations, the contrast in the colors in the flower beds, the emerald green grass, the flowers hugging the ground. And behind them, you see the ornamental shrubs, and then you see the evergreen trees. There are beautiful places where you can just sit down and relax with flowers just about everywhere. This is the Italian garden. This is the most formal of all the gardens. It was, you know, previously a tennis court of the Bouchards, and the tennis court got converted into the Italian garden. There is a, you know, flower-filled pond, and in the center of the pond, there is a cast iron statue. And all around it, you can see seasonal flowers. Now, whenever you go to the Bouchard Gardens, you know, you find something new because the flowers keep changing according to the seasons. And everything in the Italian gardens is very, very symmetrical. If you look at the, you know, the rectangular flower beds, and then you see the hedge at the back, you see those arches, white colored arches. Everything is very, very symmetrical. You can see the topiaries on the left, and you can see the flowers everywhere. All right, so this is the most formal garden of all the gardens. And there are, you know, beautiful urns. There are green umbrellas under which you can sit and you can enjoy, you know, just watching the beauty all around. Hydrangeas, marigolds, tulips. There are so many flowers. Another, you know, feature of this garden, of course, not to miss, is the gelato ice cream that is available there. And I believe cooks from Bouchard were sent to Italy to learn exactly how to make this gelato ice cream. And now it's available in various flavors, amazing flavors, and everyone can just tuck into them and enjoy themselves. Next is the Japanese garden. The Torii Gate is the entrance, the red Torii Gate is the entrance to the Japanese gardens. Once you enter, you see serene waters, stepping stones, you see pagodas. And you know, when you look at the Japanese gardens, you find that there are various shades of green. Moss green, light green, dark green, lime green, olive green. You'll be amazed at the different shades of green in the garden. And suddenly there'll be bursts of color in between. Another picture of the Japanese garden with waters flowing and the curved stepping stones. There are red bridges, there are ferns growing, there are huge mushrooms and moss. Everywhere you can see moss, even the stones are covered with moss. It's a very peaceful and tranquil garden. For me, when I entered, it seemed to just soothe my, you know, my nerves, and I felt so happy and so peaceful. I just thought, and there's so many maple trees, and you could, you know, you hear the rustling of the leaves, the maple leaves. I thought I should just sit under one of the maple trees, close my eyes, meditate, and attain nirvana. This is the rose garden. That's my son standing there. There are roses just about everywhere. There are trellises where roses are climbing. There are about 30 of these arches. And you see the different types of roses. You have ramblers, you have climbers, floribundas, and you have roses which are like shaped into bouquets, roses that are there in hanging baskets. And you see that variegated roses, there are all colors. And when you're walking through these trellises, you know, you feel, you can get the aroma, the smell, the fragrance of the roses, you know, it's a heady fragrance and you can experience it. All right. And there are roses of all colors, blood red to, you know, light pink, rosebud pink. You have blazing orange, you have yellow, lime yellow to dark yellow. You have variegated roses, you have tea roses, you have tiny miniature roses, and you have even white roses. They look so fresh and beautiful, you know, like snowflakes on a bed of green. So the and then there are lush green lawns everywhere. And I don't think, you know, this is like, I mean, it can really rival even the Garden of Eden. The rose garden is so beautiful. Now we come to the Mediterranean garden. This Mediterranean garden is very close to the parking lot. And many people somehow, they say that they miss the Mediterranean garden altogether. Mediterranean garden has got some very hardy plants, plants from all over. The Bouchards, they used to, you know, travel all over the world, especially in the winter months. Both Mr. and Mrs. Bouchard would take off to far off places. And from there, they would bring back all kinds of exotic plants and even sometimes birds. And they used to place them in their gardens. All right, so here you can see the angel's trumpet, the agave, some close to the ground, some growing tall. You have ferns, and then you have succulents. Then you have this huge urn, and peeping from behind the urn, you can see the irises. And on the left-hand side at the bottom, you see the Japanese banana plants. Now, the Japanese banana is basically grown for its ornamental value. Though the fruit is edible, in Japan, people really find it, find the flavor to be nice. They enjoy it. But I believe it's not commonly eaten in other parts of the world. Probably we need to develop a liking for it. So it's a very pleasant and sweet garden tucked away very close to the parking lot. Now we come to the rose fountain. This was, it was put in there by Ian Ross, who was a grandson of the Bouchards. Now, the Bouchards have been passing on this legacy to their children, their grandchildren, and the current owner is their great-granddaughter, Robin Lee Clark. So this fountain, the waters rise to about 70 feet in height. There are multiple nozzles, and you have, everything is so synchronized. And you see the waters going up and down, swirling and waving and cascading. You can hear the sound of the water, and it just nestled among so much of greenery. And that is a picture of Amit and Mansi, my daughter-in-law's sister and brother-in-law, posing in front of the Ross fountain. Nature in all its glory. When you go to the Bouchard Gardens, you see so many flowers, trees, and shrubs. And they all look so fresh and so beautiful. You will never see a faded bloom or a dried leaf over there. Like even the marigolds, they're so common, but they look so fresh. And I would like to, talk about this monkey puzzle tree, which is on the bottom left-hand corner. This is an evergreen tree. I was really fascinated by this tree, and I took quite a few photographs of it. And I thought this one was very attractive. So I wanted to show it to you. They say that this tree has branches growing just about in all directions, and it would puzzle even a monkey to climb the tree. And that's why it got the name, the monkey puzzle tree. These are some of the statues that are there in the Bouchard Gardens, acquired from Italy. You can see the top boar, that is Taka, the Bouchard boar. This is a replica of the boar that is there in Florence in Italy, carved by Pietro Taka in the year 1620. And this is a replica acquired from Italy. If you look at the boar, you found that you will see that the snout is shining. That's because people rub the snout, like we go to a Shiva temple and we whisper into the ear of the Nandi. And like that, people over here, they come and rub the snout for good luck. And this tradition has been passed down from Florence. From the medieval ages in Florence, people have been rubbing the snout of the boar over there, and people continue to do it even here in the Bouchard Gardens. Bottom left is the dragon fountain, acquired by the Bouchard Gardens or presented to the Bouchard Gardens in the year 2015 by the People's Republic of China. All right, for the Chinese, the dragons are not like what you see in the Game of Thrones, those fire-breathing dragons. Here, dragons are a symbol of good luck and benevolence. So this dragon, it weighs about 2,700 kilograms. And in case you are wondering which is the dragon, the person sitting in front is my husband, and the dragon is the one in the pond. Now, please turn your attention towards the picture on the right. That is the statue of the three sturgeons. The sturgeons are, of course, fish, and you can really hear the sound of the water. It's a pool surrounded by flowers, seasonal flowers, and there is a bench where you can just sit and enjoy the beauty. And the little flower sitting on the bench is my granddaughter Vani. She's a small little girl, but she enjoyed the garden. She walked everywhere without complaining. Visual extravaganza. The Bouchard Gardens have about 50 well-trained gardeners and a large staff working under them. They get up at 5, and they enter the gardens at 5:30 in the morning or even earlier. And there they do all the work of weeding and pruning, watering, fertilizing, all these things, so that the gardens are in perfect shape before the visitors begin to arrive. So you can see the sweet alizons, the peonies, the heliotropes, and ground covers, begonias. They all look so bright and so beautiful. In fact, when I saw these gardens, I thought I had to share it with somebody. And so when the cruise got over and I went back, I contacted Sakina from Friends of Trees and asked her if I could write an article for their journal. And she said, well, there's hardly any time, just send it quickly. So I shot off an article with all my photographs and it got published in the Journal of the National Society for Friends of Trees. And now I'm so happy that I'm sharing this with all of you. This is the Star Pond. Like I told you before, the Bouchards used to travel to various countries and they were very fond of birds and Mr. Bouchard especially. This was his duck pond. Initially, it was his duck pond and now it's got converted into the Star Pond, which has, which is a 12-pointed star. And the sides of the star are hedges, green hedges, and in between the hedges, you have seasonal flowers. In the center of the pond, you have the frog fountain. There are about 6 frogs spouting water. An enlarged picture of the frog can be seen in the bottom left-hand side. The top 2 extremes actually give you a bird's eye view of the pond, how the pond looks, from a distance. So it's a beautiful pond, and the Bouchards, they kept innovating, they kept adding something, kept experimenting to keep the gardens alive, to bring about changes in the gardens so that people could always enjoy them. These are the oak trees set in lush green grass and surrounded with a ring of seasonal flowers. When you look at the oaks, they really, at least they seem to take my breath away. When I was a girl studying in school, we had this change from active voice to passive voice, and we had that sentence, little strokes fell great oaks. So, when you look at the oaks, you just wonder, how can anyone really bring an oak tree down? It looks so majestic, so beautiful. It provides you with shade. Its sheer beauty is magnificent. So these are the oak trees, line of oak trees in the Bouchard Gardens. Flowers galore, once again. That's my grandson. Little boys really are not very good at posing, but Wade also enjoyed the gardens as much as his sister did. and he walked everywhere. And, you know, of course, he also enjoyed the gelato ice cream and he had things to eat, you know, because he's a foodie like his grandfather. Both my grandchildren enjoyed the gardens, though they're little kids. So you can see the lanternas, you know, here, you know, in India, they just grow wild. But when you look at them, there's vibrant colors. Everything is so vibrant. It really, you know, just takes your breath away. It's so beautiful. So that's flowers galore. Wherever you look up, you see the hanging baskets, you see the tall evergreen trees, you look down, you look to the side, everywhere you see beautiful flowers of all colors. These are the two totem poles in Alaska. The local people, they believe in carving these totem poles. They are made out of from cedar trees. And these totem poles were placed there on the 100th anniversary of the Bouchard Gardens on 9 September 2004. Now, these totem poles are 30 feet in height. And most of the totem poles in Alaska and around are symbols of history, of ancestry, of important people and events. And another thing is that what is carved on them? These are crest animals. Animals which are actually ferocious, but they have certain good qualities in them. And you will find these crest animals on the coats of arms of nobility and royalty. So here you have the orca whale, the beavers, pups, and you also have, you know, things like tigers, lions, known for their resourcefulness, their bravery, their forthrightness, loyalty, and so on. And another important thing is that these totem poles were carved in full public view. People could actually see them being carved, and once they were ready, of course, they are standing there 30 feet tall. The seed and gift shop, I said I had to go there and get some things. There are so many lovely things available. The displays are so beautiful and attractive. There are all kinds of seeds, there are books, there are caps, T-shirts, jewelry, toys, bone china items, magnets, replicas of the Bouchard Gardens. I, of course, made a beeline for the book first, and I got the book so that I could read more about the Bouchard Gardens. And then the certain knickknacks. I was so happy to see that, you know, for the first time, whenever you go to America, you keep converting everything into Indian currency. And you say, oh, this is so expensive. But when you have American dollars and you find that the Canadian dollars actually are, you know, they have less value than the American dollar, you feel, oh, things are quite reasonable. So I was very happy I made my purchases, stood in the line, but my son came, pushed me away and paid the bill himself. So that was the gift shop. Beautiful items in the gift shop. This is the rose carousel. Like I mentioned before, the Bouchards never rested on their laurels. They wanted to add something. They wanted to create something even better so that more people can enjoy them. So for those children who, you know, who want to just relax and have some fun, the rose carousel was put, you know, installed in the Rose Pavilion in the year 2009. There are 30 handcrafted animals on which children can sit, camels, zebras, horses, giraffes, and so many other animals. And of course, for the elderly people, probably those traveling with their grandchildren, there are chariots and you can sit on them because they may not feel like sitting on top of these animals, fearing that they'll fall. The trash can in the washroom, I just couldn't help taking this photograph. And the best part is that people sitting there were nicely eating their sandwiches and drinking their sodas right next to the trash can. So this is something, you know, which really fascinated me. And that's the picture of the washroom at the side. The night illuminations and fireworks. Night illuminations began in the year 1954. And if you can see how beautifully the gardens are lit up, very, very subtle. It's not that the entire garden, you know, certain areas are highlighted, certain, you know, are in darkness. And when you enter the gardens, when it is lit up, it looks like a fantasy land, absolute fantasy land. And the fireworks display started in the year 1978. And it goes on every Saturday for about half an hour. And you see, you know, they say that people who watch this fireworks display, and over the years from 1978 till today, so much has changed, so much improvement in technology. and even the aspirations of the people, the children, what they want, you know, things of culture, traditions, everything has undergone a change, and the Bouchards have kept up with these changes. And when you watch the fireworks, you see these rockets shooting up into the air, coming down and, you know, cascading into different colors, you know, and exotic patterns in the night sky, red, green, blue, yellow, purple, pink. You know, it really sets your heart on fire. The magic of Christmas. Even in the cold winter months, the garden is alive. Because the water wheel square gets converted into a skating rink. And you have adults and children skating there and enjoying themselves. And later on, they can have some hot cocoa for the children and hot coffee, which is available for the adults. The entire garden is lit up and it turns into a fairy land. And when you are walking through the gardens, you can hear the carolers singing, Silent Night, and Oh, Let Us Adore Him. So you feel, you know, it's such a divine experience entering the gardens during Christmas time. Also, there are, you know, displays of the song 12 Days of Christmas. Many of you might be familiar with the song, like, on the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge on a pear tree. That's on the top left-hand side. Then two turtle doves, three French hens, then bottom left, you have four calling birds, and bottom right, you have the five golden rings. Like that, it goes on till 12 days. So when you're walking through the gardens, you can see these displays, so beautiful, so artistic. And the ambience is absolutely awesome. It's brilliant. The open air concerts in summer. There are open air concerts in the lawns. This tradition also was started by Mr. and Mrs. Bouchard. They were great entertainers and they had these entertainment programs for their friends and relatives. The tradition continues till today, but now you have top bands and orchestras coming and giving live performances, even right from classical music to jazz. You have all kinds of music. People enjoy the summers when they come and watch these concerts, or they can just sit in the lawns and eat and enjoy themselves. The Bouchard Gardens is a garden for all seasons. There's something for people to see throughout the year, even in the bleak winter months when large parts of the earth are shrouded with a blanket of snow. You enter the Bouchard Gardens and you can see, you know, suddenly out of the snow, a beautiful crocus comes up. I was reading a book written by Michelle Obama, and she was talking about the winters in Chicago. And she said that when you see the crocus, it lifts your heart thinking, oh God, now it's going to be spring. All right, you can see the daffodils, and that's how the garden looks on the left-hand side, covered with snow. And yet sometimes, like, you see bright red cherries amidst the snow. Spring Prelude. From 15 January to 15th March, there is a restaurant called the Blue Orchid Blue Poppy Restaurant, which gets converted into an indoor garden. An indoor garden complete with a koi pond, a pond where fish are actually swimming, and little waterfalls there. And you can see the beautiful orchids, the anthuriums. And there's also a historical display where, you know, certain artifacts or, you know, photographs and furniture which the Bouchards used way back, you know, more than 100 years ago. Now, the picture on the top left is of a scoop which was used in the quarry, and today there's a beautiful display of succulents in it. And when the gardens are sleeping, people can come enter this garden, indoor garden, and really enjoy themselves in this restaurant, watching all the lovely flowers. Spring. Spring, of course, is the queen of all seasons, where the earth seems to rejuvenate itself. You have the cherry blossom, the magnolias, peonies, daffodils, tulips, rhododendrons. The tulips are planted during the fall season, and they are everywhere in spring and early summer. Summer, that's when I went, where the garden is a riot of color, hydrangeas and azaleas and lanternas and begonias and irises, buttercups, black-eyed Susans, you name it, and I think the Bouchard Garden claims it. So it's just beauty just about everywhere. Even the lawns you see look so fresh and green and beautiful. And of course, people come there to enjoy the ambience, they enjoy the concerts, and they just have fun and they go back. Autumn is another beautiful season. There are so many maple trees, and the maple leaf is a symbol for Canada, the national symbol. And you can see that the maple trees in autumn, they turn different shades of red, copper, bronze, orange, red, crimson, all kinds of colors. And the leaves come fluttering down, or the entire tree looks like, as if it looks as if the whole garden is on fire. And very quaint looking fungi seem to come out of the grass during the autumn season, as you can see on the right hand side. So that is the Bouchard Gardens. And like I said before, the gardens keep changing, they keep innovating, and they cater to all kinds of people, all kinds of tastes, and they are very, very particular about protecting the environment. These are certain environmental initiatives where they convert everything into compost and mulch. They avoid the use of chemicals, even for weed control. They have certain insects and pest control. They send them like ladybugs and all, which kill other pests and leave the good things unharmed. They use drip irrigation. In the Western countries, people use these paper bags left, right, and center. But here, all cleaning is done with reusable rags. And pets on a leash, well-behaved pets are allowed. But of course, you have to pick up the poop, and for that, you get biodegradable doggy bags. Other initiatives the compost pit over there, and bags which you get in the gift store are that's also biodegradable. As far as possible, even the restaurants, they try to use something that is local and organic. They recycle and reuse almost everything, and they have very nice water fountains with fresh water coming out, so you don't have to really carry water with you, and you have these small disposable, those bottles are not allowed. Single use water bottles are just not allowed in the Bouchard Gardens. They also try to save energy and water. They use low energy fixtures, low flush toilets. They keep recycling the water. Even all the metal wiring which they use for their fireworks and all is recycled. So these are my references, the books that I read, besides, of course, seeing the gardens with my own eyes. So that's it. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. I hope you enjoyed it.